Killing is never right. Peace is the only answer.
Be vegan, repentant, save your soul.
In this world, magical power, secular power, there is never enough to protect yourself from all harm. To slander the Buddha or any enlightened saint is one of the gravest sins. Or to kill the Buddha or to kill your parents or to hurt your parents in any way, to hurt the Buddha in any way. To hurt doesn't necessarily mean to use a knife, yeah, or physical means to hurt. To hurt also the reputation. The more you practice, the more you do not care about how much you have or not have. You just want peace, yeah, tranquility, stability in your life so that you can continue discovering your inner great self, because that is the most important thing, and we are happy to grow with that. Therefore, I say to you, if you have magical power, forget that you have it. Don't use it. Otherwise, it continues a habit. And this is just like borrowing from this physical and the astral world. You have to pay dearly, yeah? At the end, or it will cut off some of your spiritual merit points. So criminals are sometimes, many are pardonable in the eyes of heavens. You understand? And the eyes of the Master. Master always pardons them and understands them and can help them. But if a disciple already knows right from wrong, had been nourished, taught, protected, and cared for like the Master's own children, and still goes against the Master, understand me, in such a horrible way that makes the Master defenseless.
Please keep watching to find out more.
<笑>大家好，嗯，我当然要好嘛，不好也要好，<笑>不好就不能去看你们了。啊，看，啊，thank <笑>大家喝，啊，喝不？<笑>啊，呀 ，very good。嗯。 不一样，<笑>你不觉得老的，身体会告诉你。嗯，老了。<笑>啊，我姐姐就不用讲了，你做的对。我鞋子蛮干净的，干洗的啊。不过还是要，对不起了啊。哎，总远看总比没有好。知道师父还活着就好了。 嗯，别拜佛，拜佛拜天，别拜师父，别拜这个肉体了。OK， 嗯，比方说师父，你看到师父在电视上面，你会不会拜那个电视啊？不会啊，呵呵，不要了啊，拜天拜佛啊，拜菩萨。 我还是很年轻啊，你们那么老拜我。
不好意思。Okay. I thought my place was there.
That's all. Okay. All right. I sit a little higher, you know why, right? Huh? So everybody can see me. Give me my bag, huh? Don't take it away, huh? My bag. 我的袋子. He has to take it so that I am free with my hands. Understand? Yeah. Thank you. Not because I abuse his kindness or muscle. Oh, being a man is much more convenient, really. I wish I was a man sometimes. Yeah, sometimes I act like a man, man and woman in both sides, switch back and forth, very tiring. Man is when I need to move mountains, yeah? Move karma, bigger than mountains. And then woman, when I need to be gentle and sweet, you know. Some egos are bigger than a mountain. You don't know because you don't work with people, okay? Anyway, I wish I could be a man or at least be in India. Indian people are very liberal. There are some women practitioners. They don't wear anything. Do you know that? At least you saw some photos, right? People say nothing. Even go and bow to them. Touch their feet, kiss the dirt that they walk on in other country. You know, over there, police also very respectfully bow to them. Here, if I did the same, the police also would respectfully take me to a very safe area. You understand, right? Yeah. India is a great country. A lot of people think it's a poor country, but it's not poor. It's very, very rich in heritage, spiritual heritage. And we have to thank them for guarding all this spiritual culture, spiritual lineage for us so that we can continue to uplift our world with our spiritual practice. Yes, truly it's like that. But the lineage doesn't always stay in India, you know that, right? Therefore, it went to Jesus in Jerusalem, went to the Prophet Muhammad, God be with him, peace be upon him. I forgot this, I don't often say I forgot, forgive me. Yeah. The Muslims, forgive me. Peace be upon all of you, the Muslims. Peace be upon you. That means you keep peace. You always say to people, Salam alaikum. May peace be upon you, then you keep peace upon yourself first. Because if you don't have peace, how do you give peace to people, right? Mm. So I hope the Muslim brothers and sisters remember that. Remember what they wish upon everyone, regardless. That means the Muslims look upon all as equal, yes. Otherwise they wouldn't say the same to the foreigners as well as to their own kin. See? Therefore, they should remember that peace begins inside, in yourself. Yeah? Just like the Prophet, peace be upon him, if he hadn't had enlightenment within himself, how would he have transferred this enlightenment to others, his disciples and all the followers? Yeah? And still be revered all these centuries and influence millions of people across the globe, generation after generation, to worship God, to remember the origin, to remember that all religions belong to God, to remember that if you treat other beings kindly, God will treat you kindly. On the contrary, God will not be merciful upon anyone who is not kind to other beings. It says like that in the Quran, more or less. I don't know why I say so many things, jump from one country to another. Yeah, I could say things, right? I never dreamed I would say such things before, when I was younger. Before I went to the Himalaya, I knew something, but I could never speak a lot. very small talk and quiet. Yeah. One of the brothers who knew me in India, they told one of our brothers and sisters that Master was very quiet. Yeah, I think it was on TV, some of our TV before, eh? Yeah, he's a very cool guy. All right. Everyone's okay?
Yes.
You hungry yet?
No.
Yeah, better not be, because I'm going to talk for a while. Because some of you like me to sit here and talk no matter what. Even the weather forecast or the trees, the birds, anything will do, as long as I sit here and entertain you, right? 30%. 30% enlightening entertainment. The 70% is unspoken. Mm. And don't come and cry to me about your relative dying so that I have to give you another umbrella, okay? I need this. I truly need this. I live in the mountain. Everywhere I go, I don't know why I'm just living in the mountain somehow. Somehow it just happens that I got a place in the mountain. And when you are old, or I mean as young as I am, yeah, I mean, you need this to walk down a little bit. Even very thin and fragile like this, they have a lot of cushion, huh? But you have something to kind of lean on, you know, so you don't like topple. If the road is rough or if you happen to be distracted by some snails or some little cockroaches or something on the road, yeah, then you will not topple. It's very convenient. And when it rains, it protects you. When it's sunny, also can protect you, keep your skin beautiful. All right. I understand. We all have problems, yeah? We all have problems. We all have relatives and friends and loved ones who we did not want to part with yet. We don't want to, but they just leave us. Yeah, everything we love, when they leave us, we feel very, very, very tormented, you know, as if somebody in Costa Rica, when I first went there, first time ever, and then when I had to leave, they say it's like somebody, Master, going, when you leave, it's like somebody cut a piece of my flesh away, from her flesh away. Is that bad? Could be, huh? Could be, yeah. If you happen to have this situation, happen within your families or your friend circle, keep busy, okay? Do what you have to do with the physical shell that's left behind, you know, bury or, how to say, cremate it as quickly, you know, as you can. Depends, of course, on the relatives and friends, how long and sometimes in the buried people or community, they look at the date, whether or not it's an auspicious time to bury someone, etc. Depends on that. Other than that, keep busy, okay? Don't sit in the house and moan. It is very bad for your physical, emotional, and mental stability. You better keep busy. The best way is to keep busy. If you don't have a job to do, go out. Go out and help some volunteer group, okay? Go clean the ashram. And you clean in the morning, clean again at noon. Clean another time, clean the bathroom, clean the toilet. Do something else for somebody else. Because remember, no matter how tragic our situation, there are worse for some other people on our planet. There's always something going on. Yeah? War, famine, injustice, oppression. Still, in this 21st century, always something. It's because of the karma of the world, because the Maya, the illusion force has made it that way since time immemorial. And then it continues, this kind of circle, it cannot break unless you are initiated and become a real practitioner. Then you have the force within yourself which continues you're developing, and it protects you. It helps you in any time, any circumstances, okay? But keep straight your path. Don't veer left, veer right. Keep straight. Straight by the five precepts. Very simple. And remember the five holy names and meditate as much as you can at home. That's how you protect yourself in this world. Because if you look around, even in a peaceful country, we still have prisons. We still have people suffering inside, you know, the barbed walls. And sometimes injustice, not fair judgment because of fake evidence, because of situations, or being in the wrong place at the wrong time, being in the wrong color, in the wrong place. That's how things happen to people. Or even in a rich country, powerful country, we still have homelessness and poverty. Some people have no medicine to take care of themselves or live too far from the doctor. Always think like that, okay? Otherwise, we complain. I also complain, and then I have to think to myself, it could be worse, it could be worse. But I have to confess that sometimes if it's worse than that, I don't know how I bear. I don't know how I bear, even with all the master power inside. If it's worse than what it has been, or being, I don't know if I can bear. Yeah. Talking is easy. Yeah. when in a situation, it's different. Huh? Okay. All right. Anybody prepare your questions? Anyone want to ask questions? The Vietnamese, the Chinese? Yeah, tell me.
Yeah. Mục Kiền Liên, he also a disciple of the Buddha.
Yes.
Why does his mother not be able to liberate? He also have to go to hell looking for his mom.
Oh.
Yes. Can you explain more about this case?
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Some people also wanted to ask me this before. It's good that you ask me now because the other day I didn't have time to tell too much about that. Okay. Okay. I'm telling you why. His name is Maudagalayana. He's one of the foremost disciples of Buddha. You're right. Foremost, one of the foremost, not just a normal disciple. And he had strong magical power. He used to go and compete with other magicians for fun. Maybe also ego, maybe because the other magicians were not good. Yeah? So they fought. But because of that, he finally also died because of magical power. Because no matter how high you are, there'll be another higher. In this world, magical power, secular power, there is never enough to protect yourself from all harm. In this world, magical power, secular power, there is never enough to protect yourself from all harm. Yeah. Now, I'm telling you, with all his magical power, he could not save his mom. The reason was that his mom had committed the gravest sin, one of the gravest sins that you can commit. Even if you're a non-believer, even if your son or your daughter, even if he's a master, your son, your daughter, or the disciple of the most powerful master, like Buddha, for example, or Jesus, still you cannot avoid the consequences of your own actions. If there's an action, there's a reaction, retribution. She had slandered the Buddha, slandered his disciples, the pure disciples at that time. All of them were arhat and great saints, great bodhisattvas already. And they had done nothing wrong. They had done nothing wrong to her, physically, emotionally, mentally, psychologically, spiritually, nothing. They were innocent, but she kept slandering them. you know, to other people to make sure nobody believe the Buddha. You know, whomever she could, she slandered the Buddha and the Sangha. I guess she was following another kind of faith, but with the wrong concept. Like, her faith was the only one. The rest, whoever knew, was not true, you know? Yes. Just like when Jesus was alive, people were still waiting for him to come. They always thought Messiah would come one day. And then when Baha'u'llah, God bless him, arrived, they were also waiting for another master to come. Yes. And when Guru Nanak came, they were still waiting for the Savior. So very few people follow him. Even though look like a lot, yeah, maybe even millions. But how much is millions? In the world, you have billions, okay? Thus, you know, whatever master comes, they're still waiting for a messiah. Mm. Same with when the Buddha arrived, they were still waiting for a messiah, the savior. They did not believe in him. Similarly, maybe she was following another set of doctrines, saying that the messiah would come, and everyone else was not true. In some of the religious faith nowadays, they still think like that. They still think that maybe that was the last one, a last prophet, a last savior, no one else after that. So we cannot argue with all this. Fine, we don't have to. And nobody needs to believe in anyone if they don't want to believe, but you should not slander. In case that being, that person has attained sainthood, then you will be punished severely. It's not the saint that punishes you. It is the law of cause and effect in this world. Thus, Mauda Galiyayana's mother was one of them who had bad mouth, bad seed of karma, bad influence from her, maybe her faith. Maybe the people who led her into that faith. Maybe somebody who was jealous of the Buddha and indoctrinated her into many wrong concepts, made her become, you know, slanderous of the Sangha and the teachings of the Buddha and the Buddha personally, even though her son was a disciple. Or maybe she had no faith at all. She loved her son, like all mothers do. And sometimes too much love becomes possessiveness, yes. And thus, when her only son, the beloved of her life, the jewel in her eyes, left her home and became a monk, following the Buddha everywhere, and became a renunciate, she could not tolerate it. Similar as many mothers, when her son is married to another woman, and the daughter-in-law is another woman, and she cannot bear it. And then there are many things happening within the family, yeah, with the in-laws. Well, this is famous anyway. I'm not saying bad things about anybody. It just happened. Just happened. Especially if her husband had left the world and she had only one son, and that was all her life. And if this so-called life was taken away from her, she became furious. And then she became, you know, very, very bad like that. To slander the Buddha or any enlightened saint is one of the gravest sins. Or to kill the Buddha, or to kill your parents, or to hurt your parents in any way, to hurt the Buddha in any way. To hurt doesn't necessarily mean to use a knife, yeah, or physical means to hurt. To hurt also the reputation, yeah, hurt the reputation. To make that person be so degraded, that saint degraded, humiliated, or harassed in any way. not even physically, is the same as making the Buddha bleed. Making any Buddha bleed is a grave sin, according to the sutra. And I know that also. That is true. Or slandering any Buddha, you go to the so-called non-stop hell, meaning you never get out. You can never get out of that. And you could never be pardoned, no matter how many masters come and go, because you denied the representative of the truth and the goodness and the virtues. You turned your back from it. That means you'll be there forever. Got that? So the mother of this great monk had to go to hell according to the law of karma, which governs this entire physical world. That means the Maya, the illusionary force, can do with her what it wants. Yeah? No one can interfere. Even the Buddha cannot. Because Maura Galayana went to hell. He had the power to go to heaven, high heaven, at will. And he couldn't even go to hell at will. Whatever hell, the deepest hell he could go to. He was a disciple of the Buddha. And he also had magical powers. He went there and saw his mother suffering so much. Not only did she slander the Buddha and defame the Sangha, she cooked meat, you know, and invited the monks to eat. Cheated them, understand me? Cheated them to eat meat so that they would also commit this the offenses. Because the Buddha had declared already they should not eat meat, the real monks should not eat meat. And she cheated them. She said, oh, he's a vegetarian. She pretended to be nice and pious, and then invited them and then gave them this impure food to eat. Therefore, she went to the nun. We have everlasting life, but we have also everlasting hell. She went to that kind of hell. Over there, she is always feeling hungry, thirsty, but she can never eat anything. Even her son, the great monk, came down there to bring food, use his power to manifest food to give to his mother. As soon as she swallowed, it became burning cold and burning her throat and her body. Continuously, she can never eat anything. Forever hungry because she gave the wrong food to the Sangha. So her extra karma is like that. Normally, if you are enlightened and practice diligently, then 5, 6, up to 9, 10 generations will be liberated forever. Might not be on the fifth level yet, but can be guaranteed of ultimate liberation gradually because of your merit and because of your master's power. This one is an exception because she denied everything and she degraded everything that was meritorious for her due to her son. Can you imagine how much more if people even kill the Buddha and all that? Everyone, even disciples or non-disciples who slander the Buddha, will all really go to hell, whether or not the master wants it. The same with the disciples of Jesus who betray him, even though maybe not intentionally, maybe being cheated into it. And another one, Devadatta, who was always against the Buddha, the same. He would have gone to hell for a long time. And even with the power of the Buddha, maybe long eons after kalpas, after billions, trillions, gazillions of years, maybe they can fish him out. But then he would do a bad thing again. And then go back to hell again. The seed inside cannot always be destroyed by hellfire, even for thousands of billions and zillions of kalpas, meaning uncountable lifetimes. Yeah, I told you, it's very difficult to be a master because you can't please everyone. And there are many established long-time doctrines already, yes? And due to people's ignorance, not understanding the doctrines of the past masters and saints, and due to the ignorance of the so-called leaders, religious leaders, you know, the blind leading the blind, both will fall someday. Thus, the public are being misled, believing something that is not true, is not the truth, is not correct. And so they all become very ignorant and arrogant and do not treat the real saint, the real savior nicely. Thus, they have problems. Even though they might come and follow such and such master, maybe just for fun, maybe just because they're a friend, and just because their wife going, you want to check out what's the wife doing in the assembly, why she keep going every Sunday and doesn't stay home, or the husband, why, whether or not he has another woman or something, so they just join just to check out. Or just join because there's a girl he fancy or the boy she likes, blah, blah, blah. And if anything she doesn't like anymore, she comes out and then, because they don't understand, don't want to listen, nothing, just follow that goal only, the object only, not follow the master's teaching. So they do not understand. So any little unpleasantness, she or he will come out and turn against the master. The same life after life like that. It's very difficult. Difficult. Also, the master also has former enemies coming back. And they also follow maybe, but they're doing many things that are harmful to the master and the assembly. You know, maybe not physically, but, you know, mentally hurting the reputation, or obstructing the teaching, obstructing other people, you know, making their faith waver, something like that. Milarepa, even though he had so few disciples already, his master told him, don't go out, don't preach to anybody, don't accept anyone as your disciple. Most people in the world, they only want material blessings. They don't really want to practice. That's why mostly he hid himself in some remote mountain, eating even just some nettle leaves to survive. And rather than go down in the village or town where people would make offerings to him. In Tibet and India, there is still this wonderful tradition that they make offerings to the renunciate or the saint, if they believe you are the saint. They don't question a lot. So yeah, that's what I'm told. I told you, I wish I was in India. Oh, a man, you know, in India, and if you're a man, it's also easy. They don't question you a lot. And some people have problems. Some master have problem maybe in another country, but they accept him in India. They never question him. And when he comes back, they also don't question. They don't put him in jail like in other country. They don't make trouble. If you say you are sane and you are not, then it is your problem. You will have to answer to heaven, because that's also one of the worst sins you can commit, telling lies about your spiritual attainment when you don't have it. That's also the worst thing you could do to yourself. And plus 5, 6, 7, 9 generations with you. Because if you fall, they fall too. Even though Mu Qianlin, you know, Maudala Gayayana, did not fall. His mother still fell. Only his mother, the rest, nobody mentioned it. That means they were liberated. Only the mother who was so wicked. That's why. So do not think that if you are initiated by any master, you can commit anything you want. You can say anything you want, or even go against the master, and the master still will save you. Maybe. But that's very risky. In this world of illusion, you must adhere to the rules and regulations in this world. Yes? Suppose you are even the president of a free country, but if you go to another restricted, politically sensitive country, you still cannot do anything against the rules of that country. Can you? Okay. Similarly, even when the master comes into this world, he has to also respect the law, okay? Least of all the disciples. We have to adhere to the five precepts, okay? Otherwise, I just give you initiation. Do what you want, you're free. You are free. You are free. Of course, if you walk the straight path, both sides, you know, there's some country, there are landmines, yeah? If they already clear the road for you and they say, this road you can walk, the left you cannot, the right you cannot, the behind you cannot, and you should not, because you will be dead or maimed or lose your limbs. Similarly, in this world is similar to a landmine field. You have to walk straight, okay? The master clear the road for you, but you have to walk. It's very risky in this world, dangerous world. You look around you, huh? Sometimes even I was scared when I was in Europe. Sometimes I had to go out in the car, somebody else driving, so I didn't have to look at the road. Sometimes I look around, I saw advertising for meat so big on the board next to the street. And I shudder, you know, I was thinking, what kind of world am I living in? Before they even killed people to eat, it was a long, long time ago, yeah? And now they kill animals to eat. Sometimes kill the animals alive, or kill dogs even, or skin them alive. It's horrible. It's very difficult to live in this world, okay? And I'm very glad that you still can come to group meditation, that you can meditate at home, you know, with little obstruction. Despite your busy schedule and your family obligation, your job duty, you still can do what you can to protect yourselves. I'm so glad and I appreciate your effort, because I know how difficult it is already to live in this world uninjured, you know, emotionally or physically, mentally, psychologically, spiritually even. So count your blessings. Always count your blessings and do not complain. I'm also having to count my blessings every day so I don't complain, so that I don't break down. Because sometimes it's really hard to be a master. It doesn't always look rosy, like I'm sitting here talking to you in peace. It's not like that, okay? I cannot list it all for you. We count our blessings. Every day we thank heavens, thank goddesses or goddesses to have protect us so that we have such a fortunate life. Many people don't have what we have. No matter how little you have, you still are very lucky, huh? Yes, yes. And the more you practice, the more you do not care about how much you have or not have. You just want peace. Yeah, tranquility, stability, in your life, so that you can continue discovering your inner great self, because that is the most important thing, and we are happy to grow with that. And that your brother, he asked only one thing before he died, huh? He didn't ask, Master, give me riches, give me diamonds, give me gold, give me a house, give me cars, give me a better wife, nothing. He asked just for proof of enlightenment. You do have. It's just that... Maybe you are looking in the wrong direction. You're expecting different things. Okay? Whatever you have, continue. It's good. You just misunderstand. But it happens also, yeah, if your mind is somewhere else. In the Buddha's time, there was one monk who also imparted the light and sound from the Buddha. And then he went to the forest to meditate alone. But he had no experience of the sound. And he came back and asked the Buddha why. Other people asked for him and he say, the Buddha say that because he doesn't concentrate on that. He concentrates only on the light. It's not that you say, okay, I concentrate on the light and then you can. It's not like that, okay? It's your mind sometimes. It's a wandering tool, yeah? It's a troublemaker. But without the mind, you also cannot practice, okay? And then there's another guy, another monk, who also got the light and sound. But he came back, he said, because he went near a village to meditate. And his hut was destroyed by weather. And he asked the villagers to build him another hut. They say they would, but then days after days, weeks after weeks, months after months, they did not do it. So during all that time that he stayed there in the summer retreat, he had not an iota of light come to him, meaning not even a flash of light came to him. The same thing, because he has no concentration. He can't. He is exposed to all these kind of elements, yeah? He has no roof over his head, yeah? Imagine he's a monk. He doesn't have much to do, and still just the weather bothering him, then he could not have a light, not to talk about you. You have so much work to do. Everything just wants to take your attention away. Thus, you are in difficulty to concentrate. I sympathize very much with you, but nevertheless, I'm still very proud of you and very glad that you still hold on to your faith and continue your road to enlightenment. The Master Power will bless you, will help you, no matter what level you are. As long as you don't harm others, as long as you continue to have faith, when you die, Master will always take you. Okay? Okay. I talk again about Milarepa, okay? Milarepa, the master told him, his master told him not to go down into the world. Just hide yourself somewhere in the mountain. Meditate alone. Don't bother about the humans. He talks like that, but he himself had disciples. You know, if you are saying, people smell it, know it. Even inside some gods or some angel would tell them, you see, and then they go and find you. That's how they discovered me three times. In the beginning, when I wasn't aware that I was a master of some sort. I'm still not aware now, but since you came, I teach you something, okay? Teach you what I know. And if it's good for you, then you continue to practice. If it's not good for you, you're welcome to leave. Nobody will ever say anything. Just don't slander, because you never know. Maybe I'm really a master. Maybe I don't look like, but maybe I am a master. Then you'll be in trouble, huh? Yeah, I'm warning. All right. Now, but Milarepa, of course, he normally was hiding in the mountain. I don't know, somehow people found out. And because what kind of real man, what kind of human would stay in the mountain without any clothes on in the winter and eat only nettle leaves until he became all green, like a caterpillar, even growing green hair all over. And so people even ask him, are you real? Are you human or are you preta? Means, are you a hungry ghost or are you human? And he said, I'm human. Yeah, he should have said, I'm a ghost and scare them all away. Then he would not have any trouble at the end of his life. I will tell you. Well, you know the story, I guess. Somehow people smelled and smoked him out. Huh? Just like when I was meditating 3 months, eating brown rice sesame alone without anything else. Salt, of course. And then Somebody say that Kuan Yin Bodhisattva told them to go to that temple. They had never been there before to find a master. Right, that's how I was discovered in Taiwan, okay? In India, I was discovered already because I wanted to buy a book and they said they didn't have it. I said, you have it. You know, I saw it in your shop with such a color, you know, such a size, and then they thought I was a Buddha already. So at least one of them follow me wanted to be my disciple, okay? So I tested him and he passed. So I had to keep my promise, get one. My first disciple, so-called, on the bank of the Ganges River. I had no temple, nothing, no shaved head, nothing. I just wore white clothes, you know, like most Indians. All right, that was my first discovered mission. Okay, I went to Taiwan. I was discovered again. I just told you, I live in a temple, behind the temple, very obscure area where they keep the ashes of the dead people. I live among the dead, among the dead. They still found me out, a group. They came in such a night, thunder, storm, raining, I never forget. Yeah, they came in because they saw in a hurry. Why didn't come in daytime, you know? Came in the night, knocking at my little dead quarters. Yeah. And I had to give them. Fine. Because they said the Bodhisattva gave them the direction. For the respect of the Bodhisattva, I had to, know. And then I ran away to America. And they discovered me again. A group of black and white people came to the temple where I was cleaning the toilets and wiping the floor every day and cooking for the whoever came and for the abbot as well. They came and they say, we know. Someone appear inside our vision to tell us to come here, this address. They never been there before. None of them have been there before and none of them had been to that ashram, you know, the dead room before. They found a way to come. And they say that, come here and then you teach us to listen to the sea, yeah. And your name is Master G. Actually, G is the name that is addressed to any great person, you know? Like great, G means great, Master G. I say, no, you're looking for the abbot, right? I say, no. They say, not the abbot, Master G. And then the other one say, no, Master Ching, I think, Ching. They argue with each other, Ching or Chi. I say, no, the abbot's name is so-and-so. He's not here right now. Maybe you come back after 2 months when he comes back to America. I say, no. Not a man, I say, it's a woman. And over there, only me. The abbot is a man, I'm a woman, yeah? And other lay people come and go, yeah? To learn with him. So I also had to teach them. That's the third time. See what I'm saying? They smell you. Yeah. In India, maybe they smell you faster. If you just sit on the bank of the Ganges, you will have things. You have food, you have people come, touch your feet, ask you to teach them. In India, people, they are very liberal in spiritual practice. Yes. If they see you, maybe they can see your aura. Yeah, your aura, and then they know you are good or not good. Some people who don't see you aura, but if you wear renunciate robes, grow along there a little bit, then I'm sure you can be a master. So whoever says you already attained Buddhahood, just go there. You'll be worshipped in no time. No problem. No problemo. Now, Milarepa, disciple of Mapa the Great, yes. Mapa, master told him not to go anywhere. Go hide, okay? Don't go down the mountain. Don't go near people. Don't teach anybody. If you want to keep your life intact and your spiritual unhindered, don't go near humans. Therefore, he stayed all the way there. But then some people even discover him. And then sometimes he went down He taught them something. Maybe he did not go down, but he taught them something. There were four nuns who came and learned with him and asked him to go back to their village so he could teach other people. He said, no, I am here. It's good for me. I don't want to go down. But then still some people became his followers and so-called disciples. One of them, very, very envious of his fame and all the respect that the people gave to Milarepa. He poisoned the master, Milarepa. I think poison, right? Huh? I think so, yes. A long time already since I read this. Long. Well, at least 30-some years ago, when I still had time to read, you know? Like in India or whatever, yes. And now I don't have time to even read my own mind, what I want this morning or not. Ah, God. If you sit next to me, you will complain also, like my dog the other day. I have time, no time for dogs. I have no time for myself even. Thank God you come every week so I take a shower, you know, and smell nice, yeah, and wear new clothes. If not, I'm very comfortable with whatever, okay? No time for thinking even, yeah? Now, one of Milarepa's disciples, a man who was very envious, jealous of him, poisoned him. And then the master, Jesu Milarepa, was in agony, of course. In those times, maybe they're so wicked, they gave him the poison that won't kill immediately, but he had to agonize for a long time before he died. And then he came, because of other disciples around, you know, concerned, and he also pretended to be concerned. He said, oh, Master, why don't you give me all your pain so that you will be relieved? Yeah. He poisoned him and then pretended to be kind to the Master. So the Master said, no, you could not bear it. Such a pain, you could not bear it. I can, because maybe I have a little power, thanks to my Master, Mapa. But you could not bear it. So he still insisted. Please, Master, please give all the suffering to me so that you will be free. Blah, 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 blah. And because Milarepa had some magical power and as habit, we'll have it. If you have miracle power, you cannot not use it, good or bad. Yeah. Therefore, I say to you, if you have magical power, forget that you have it. Don't use it. Otherwise, it continues a habit. And this is just like borrowing from this physical and the astral world. You have to pay dearly, yeah? At the end, or it will cut off some of your spiritual merit points. A lot, big chunk. If you eat just simple food and you pay for it, and still have a lot of spiritual merit points to compensate, how would it be if you borrow something that's invisible, that you could not even pay back? So this person pretended to be nice to the master, kind, compassionate, and all that, and maybe doing this kind of sympathetic face, maybe shed a few crocodile tears. And the master said, no, you could not bear it. After he kept insisting, the master said, Jesun, Milarepa, say to him, okay, I will transfer some percent of it into this door, and then you see how powerful, how painful it can be, 1%. So he did some magic. He just waved his hand, and then the door crumbled into dust. Understand that? Yes. I wouldn't bother, because he knows that this is the person who poisoned him. Maybe he wanted to show him that he had enough power to kill him, but he didn't want to. Maybe that. But I wouldn't bother. You are dying already. What for do you have to prove it to anyone? But as I told you, habits die hard. Okay? If you have power, you cannot not use it. It's the same with governments. If you are in a powerful position, you have to really use it carefully. Very difficult. Just one stroke of your pen, somebody might die, or somebody can live. Something can happen to some people or some family. It's a very difficult position. That's why since time immemorial, many political figures have not fared well. Even if they want to keep themselves spotlessly clean, they're still relatives, friends, you know? or wife and husband. I told you one of the stories before, of the man who was born without any hand or feet, just a little male organ, and then he inherited. He was still counted as male. Just a little difference like that. And I have to wear these clothes, those clothes, inside, outside, otherwise criticized. Being a man, it's easy. You don't even have to wear any clothes. You come down, nobody says anything. Many men in India, they don't wear, the monks or the practitioners, they renounce everything. They don't want to bother with the world, to have any complications, you know, to go with the clothes and the food and all the decorations or so-called necessities. I also wish sometimes I could be like that, but I do it only at home. Yeah, because it's a cumbersome. The clothes, you have to either wear the what? The belt or all this, what? Elastic band. What if it broke? Yeah, it breaks somewhere. Yeah. Well, lucky I wear some very long dresses. You know now why I wear long dresses. It's safe for this way. Otherwise, I will be in all over national TV, whatever, who knows. Yeah, become more famous. I'm already very famous in Taiwan. Wherever I go, people know. I go to a non-disciple restaurant. They still recognize me. At the airport, not just in Taiwan, but everywhere. It is a nuisance to be famous, okay? You can't have enough privacy. Now, that person who poisoned Ilarepa at the end of his life went to hell forever, this kind of forever hell. Don't think. Only in Milarepa's time that happened. It still happens now, in my lifetime. That's why I'm telling you, I always count my blessings, that I'm still alive. That's this. Just, you know, something. But it didn't take my life, okay? Yeah. It's just that person is burned beyond recognition after that. But the soul, you understand, is almost destroyed. It's not about the physical body that you don't feel, you don't see it. It's the soul that's going to be destroyed. Luckily, the master has the power and can help. But that doesn't mean that person will not go to hell for a long time, at least for a long time. I don't know how long. I'm telling you, a long time ago, I have a story for you here. A long time ago, there was a master, huh? And he was very pious and powerful. I mean, in a good way. He could save souls and rescue people. And the king of that country was also very good to him, yes? So he gave him a piece of land and he built something for him to stay in. And then his disciples could also come and stay and listen to him now and then. Yeah, okay. But then some of the disciples were not content with just coming and going. They wanted to stay there forever, okay? And then slowly they took up everything. And then the master is uncomfortable because what kind of teacher can stay with the students 24/7, huh? Or even every other day or every few days, yeah. And then they put up tents everywhere and right in front of his house, and he could not go out to the bathroom without people trailing behind, yeah, wanting to paint a picture. Not with a toilet, I guess, I hope, but still trailing around. He could not even sit down to eat without people staring in his mouth. He could not even have any conversation with his mother or sister or brother without somebody sitting listening to the private details. He could not even talk to his doctors about his illness, yeah? Of course, from the karma, eh? Without everybody listening. They even sat around him, you know, around his bed all day, all night, whenever they came. So the master left. He could not bear it and left for a while, went somewhere. And then they took up everything, of course, right? And then After a while, they didn't have the master. So one of the so-called disciples said, hey, maybe we are too possessive here. That's why the master cannot bear it. And he left already. Why don't we maybe leave the place for the master to stay alone? Mm-hmm. And then we can come to see him at his convenience. You know, he is getting older. He also needs rest. Okay? So, okay, they all left.
Yeah.
But one of the so-called disciples was not happy with that. She came, stayed there a long time. It was cheaper, no need to pay any rent, nothing. I put up a tent there and just stay. The ashram always have some food. I like that. Came and went whenever she wanted, like her own house. So was reluctant to leave, didn't want to leave. And by the way, one of the other disciples, her friend, yeah? There are two friends, two females. One didn't have magic power, was not aware that she had magic power. But there were friends in many other lifetimes.
There were
magicians, black magicians. And follow the master, of course, didn't exercise any more power. Fine. Another one of her friends, yeah, happened to do something that was wrong and harmful to the whole assembly, yeah? So the master asked her to leave. And then this friend came and, gossip with the black magician friend. And this magician got this excuse to curse upon the place of the master. Not only that, but the master also got affected. He could
have
averted
it.
He could have returned this power to that magician person. But he could not do that. Number one, he didn't have the heart to do that. He was not used to doing this kind of bad thing. Number two, the karma of the disciple, he must bear. Okay? But that person's soul has been burned almost like black coal, until the master came and embraced her inside and repaired her damage. But still, that person still needs to go to hell for a long time. Let me see how long. I saw this inside the vision, okay? So I noted it down. It's not in any book. But if you see Maudgalyayana's story, then you should know. It's similar. Okay, the one that cursed the master and put a forbidden fortress into his place so that he come back, they invite him to come back, but he could not live in there. Live very uncomfortably, Some days headache, some days stomach ache, some days heart problem. Some days blood pressure, some days insects come and invade his quarter, etc., etc. And also the assistant around the master also became infected, yeah? And they also work against the master. Anything the master said, they could not listen. They didn't listen well. Even if he said black, they would do white. It was so obvious. And when the master first came, he was also very kind of stretch out if you want. Okay, stretch out. All right. So when the master first came, he was also feeling very bad. Headaches, forgetting things, feeling like something was draining his energy. And also very kind of blurry, vision. It's kind of like you are in a kind of forgetfulness, some kind of different physical ability, different than before. You understand me? Yeah, forgetting things, writing things not as precisely as before, and kind of inside, a little bit like blurry, kind of a dizziness inside. Sometimes physical. Got that?
Yeah. Felt
like a different person. A much older, and forgetful, and not easy to handle daily things anymore. It was a very difficult time for the master. But the master still had to continue to do the work, you know, much other work to do. That master also did not rely on donations. He did some work, some artwork to support himself. Thus, there are many things to do, and the government also came and went and all that, the people, the guests, and he had to take care of many things, yeah? All right. It was a very difficult time. But for that so-called disciple, it's even worse, yeah? Although she didn't know it, because the mind, the body prevents you from knowing what you are doing. Yeah, and what your levels or what's happening to your soul. Got that? To your existence in the universe. So she didn't know yet. But luckily, the master rescued her on time. No, but that person, disciple, has to go to hell for 114,121 years. And then, after that, she became a snake. A poisonous snake, reincarnated as a poisonous snake, and had to live among the population so that anyone who saw the snake would bit her. The animals also harassed the snake. For 922 years, she could not bite herself to death. Poisonous snake could not bite herself to death. For 922 years. And then she reincarnated again as a fox, a very malicious fox, for 411 years. And then she became a wolf, but very hungry, difficult to catch anything to eat, and being harassed and wounded by other animals because she was weak, a weak wolf, yeah. But still could not die. Could not be eaten. That wolf wouldn't be eaten, wouldn't be dead, just being beaten or harassed all the time in her life for 323 years. Like this, I look as scholarly, huh? Like I know something. Like I'm a very learned person. For 323 years, she has been harassed. Molested wolf. And then she became a lion for another 225 years, also being hungry, thirsty, and being in the wrong place and always being harassed instead of catching any prey. And then after that, she became a human with no vision, no hands, not a very good mind, could not speak, could not hear very well. She was not a very functional human, okay? Arms, legs were all deformed. And then she became like a leprous person, understand? The hands keep eating themselves up, and the feet, and from inside also some worms also eat her up from inside, but couldn't get rid of it. No medicine can cure it. Cured and then came back again and again for 22 years, yeah? And then, but also a very violent person, even without all that, still a very violent person. Therefore, of course, being captured and by the government, put in prison and all that, and being beaten up by inmates, yeah? Because of a violent temper. And then she went back to hell because of doing violent things in the world due to the past karma. It could not be erased and escape. The karma, even though the master erased it for you, if you're doing bad things, it will come running back, okay? Nothing can be destroyed forever unless you escape from that. Like, okay, you might escape from the fire, then you're unharmed. But if you continue to stay there, you will inhale the smoke and die even if you're not burnt. Got that? So the master takes you away from this karmic zone of yours so that you can be free, huh? Forever, yeah? And then because of that, you know, being violent, beating up people, killing others, she went to hell for 73 years. And then she became human again. After being washed up, came back, became human again, but brainless, handicapped, the same again. And then became a hungry ghost. I just wrote it quick, so not too much detail, okay? But you can imagine the rest, okay? Human brainless, what do you do, huh? And then became a hungry ghost for 95 years because she never contributed anything to anyone while she was alive, yeah? Apart from all the wickedness and black magic, wrongly used power, she never been kind or despite the master teaching her to be kind to other people. You know, you don't have to give money or possessions. You just be kind, yeah? Or you be supportive of good people. Like if somebody gives somebody $5, you're happy in your heart that the person is doing a good deed and the needy person has some help. Then you're happy. You know, in Chinese, they can huanxixin, means you're happy to see somebody doing a good deed. That is also a kind of charity. I told you before, yeah? Okay. Not even that. Anyone who is kind of famous or doing good things, she envied. And she slandered them, thinking, oh, I'm just doing that for fame. You understand me? For being famous is not good. So therefore, she became a hungry ghost for 95 years. Huh? Because while being a human, she's brainless. Now there's no chance to know what to do. No chance to even be happy when somebody else was doing good deeds. Least of all, to even give anything to anyone. Always given a human chance in order to do things good, to redeem your past mistakes and to practice spiritually. But a brainless person, how? You see that? Even looks like a human, but is not 100%. So she could not do anything more to get out of her trouble, get out of her bad retribution, yeah? And so she could not even think of helping anybody, herself even being helpless. You got that? Okay. So she became a hungry ghost for 95 years. And then while being a hungry ghost, the yaksa demons keep eating her flesh, you know? Today buy this, tomorrow buy that. So all day long, even though being a ghost is not peaceful, being eaten by the yaksa demons. And then she went back to hell again, because no merit. But when the yaksa beat her, she got angry and, you know, schemed to revenge and all that. Of course, all this will lead you back to hell. She went back to hell again. To be a human, because she was once a practitioner, she had mastered power and protection. At least she had been given a chance again and again and again to be a human, but still no use. She went back to hell again for 2,326 years, etc., etc., etc. Like this, she continues forever in lower life forms, human or non-human. Okay, end of story. I'm sorry, it's a sad story, but maybe somebody needs it. So it's not like you have been initiated by Master and then you do what you want and thinking, oh, Master will rescue me in any way. She says she would rescue the worst criminals. Criminals are different, okay? They fall into the situation. They have been maybe brainwashed by society that's around them, by their friends, or by circumstances. Sometimes they have worse crimes, but maybe because of self-defense. Maybe the situation forced them to, or maybe even wrongly accused, or maybe just being forced to do it by someone else. If not, he or his family will be in trouble. For example, you got that, you know that. People blackmail, force, coerce. They blackmail others, yeah? Innocent or vulnerable victims. And coerce them into doing bad things against their will also. So criminals are sometimes, many are pardonable in the eyes of heavens. You understand? And the eyes of the master. Master always pardons them and understands them and can help them. But if a disciple already knows right from wrong, had been nourished, taught, protected, and care for like the master's own children and still goes against the master. Understand me? In such a horrible way that makes the master defenseless. If the criminal comes to your house, maybe they wield a knife or something, you still maybe can find something to defend yourself. And you can see the enemy coming, yeah? Or even if they shoot you, you can maybe step aside or use something to cover yourself. You understand that? Maybe you have a chance to defend. But using black magic, nobody sees, nobody knows. And even if the master knows, he cannot defend himself. Because the master always bears everything. Because if he had turned all that magic power against her, she'd have immediately gone out of existence. No one could ever rescue her, no chance whatsoever. Even if she went to hell, she still could come back, have a human life, maybe repent, maybe do some good deeds, still have a little chance, some here and there. You got that? Still have the soul hanging in there for one day, have a chance to be redeemed. But if the soul is completely annihilated, gone out of the universal existence forever, then sayonara, yeah. Okay then, so you be good, keep the five precepts and meditate. That's all I ask. Meditate as much as you can. Okay, huh? And now I wish you bon appetit. Means good food. If you have no time, take something with you in your cup and eat in the car, in the bus, or eat at home. Sorry about my late appearance. I can't always do it like scheduled on time, you know? Not like SMTV, 2 o'clock comes war, 3 o'clock comes that, you know? Okay? But for that, we have to work irregular hours for the TV to be on time. We have to work many odds and ends hours. Whoa, you have no idea. All night is a normal schedule for us. Not normal, but very often. The SMTV staff knows that. The ones who stay inside together in the office or the ones outside in the world know that. You should meditate with joy, yeah, with love. Yeah, with love and with joy. And help others with joy and with love. That's all we have to do. Nah? Okay, see you next time. And I love you forever. I always say that to my dogs, to you also, the same. Dogs also initiate it. Yeah. Okay, love you. May God bless you and protect you always. May you be well and progress spiritually and in every other good way in your life. Ciao. Okay, okay. 修行啊，有会有帮助世界的 ，OK？你们来达禅都会帮助自己、帮助国家、帮助自己国家、帮助世界，啊，帮助当然亲戚朋友啊，都有用 ，OK？都有用。拜拜。Thank you, 谢谢大家拥护，拜拜。够冷了哈，开始冷一点哈，啊，大家保暖 ，OK？ 保暖，照顾自己啊，客气，客气，谢谢，谢谢来大餐，啊，你们去吃饭啊，一路顺风，
谢谢师父。
对不起啦，今天快点走 ，OK？ 我还有工作很多。
好，谢谢啦。哎，
哇，红米好吃啊！
什么东西？
面非常好吃，饭非常好吃，炒菜炒饭非常好吃，蔬菜也好吃。
Be veg, go green to save the planet.